I have a question for you. When I bring up Mexican independence, who comes to mind? Probably Miguel Hidalgo, the Catholic priest that sparked the war for independence with his Grito de Dolores, a moment which would recognize him as the father of our nation. Or perhaps you think of José María Morelos, Vicente Guerrero, Guadalupe Victoria, and you probably also think of Agustin de Iturbide. All of these men were leaders that fought for Mexico's independence from Spain. As such, these men are often considered heroes of Mexico's independence. And rightfully so for people like Morelos or Vicente Guerrero, who at one point was one of the only active commanders still fighting for Mexico's independence. Now, Agustín de Iturbide has also been considered a hero of Mexican independence. However, I personally am not willing to give him that much praise. Welcome back, you guys know me, I'm Internet Mexican. So, if you watched my last video on Vicente Guerrero, or if you're already familiar with Mexican history, then you know who Agustin de Iturbide is. You're also familiar with his role in Mexico's independence. You know that on February 24th, 1821, Iturbide penned the Plan of Iguala, which outlined Mexico's independence through the creation of a Mexican monarchy independent of Spain. Iturbide also joined his forces with Vicente Guerrero, creating the Army of the Three Guarantees, taking the role of commander-in-chief of the combined rebel force. Iturbide would then lead the Army of the Three Guarantees into Mexico City on September 27, 1821, and the following day, Mexico would be declared independent from Spain. So given his obvious contribution towards Mexico's independence, why do I not consider this man to be a hero? Specifically, why don't I consider him a hero of Mexico's independence? Why don't I feel he deserves this praise that so many people give him? Now I'm going to make this very clear. In this video, I'm going to be expressing my opinion on a historical figure in Mexico's history. And then let me know whether or not you agree or disagree. Agustín de Iturbide was born in what is modern day Morelia in the state of Michoacán. He was born to a privileged land-owning Spanish family. As an American-born Spaniard, he is what we call a criollo. Criollo is a designation under the caste system implemented in New Spain, which classified people based on their racial identity. Specifically, criollo is a Spaniard born in the Americas. Now, given his ancestry, it's clear that he had a very privileged life, as his status granted him access to various opportunities not available to those in the lower classes, such as Afro-Mexicans, indigenous Mexicans, or mestizos. Literally any other group there wasn't criollo or peninsular. As a teenager, Iturbide would go on to serve in the Royalist Army, eventually being commissioned as a lieutenant in 1806. When the War for Independence began in 1810, Miguel Hidalgo would approach Agustin and offer him the rank of general of the insurgent forces. Iturbide would go on to deny this offer as he did not want to be associated with the rebels, which he referred to as bandits, perverse, sacrilegious, and barbaric. It also didn't help that in early engagements during the War of Independence, the insurgent forces also engaged in atrocities against Spaniards caught in their warpath. Agustin actually made his disdain for the rebel forces clear. So much so that there's actually a record of him bragging about having executed 300 rebels in celebration of Good Friday. As an officer in the Royalist forces, Iturbide would go on to fight against various leaders of Mexico's independence movement, such as Vicente Guerrero and José María Morelos. Matter of fact, Iturbide would face the forces of José María Morelos several times through the war, eventually defeating him on January 5, 1814. After this victory over Morelos, Iturbide would go on to relentlessly pursue the rebel leader until his eventual capture and execution in 1815. Now, although Mexico was fighting to become independent from Spain, it wasn't necessarily fighting to abolish the monarchy. A lot of Mexicans actually supported a monarchy. That being said, the later rebel movement was pretty liberal in its leanings, with two of its goals being racial equality and land redistribution. The thing is that these goals aren't aligned with the interests of the Mexican elite classes of which Iturbide was a part of. For why would the land-owning elites support land redistribution? More so, why would they support racial equality when a huge part of their privilege came from the perks associated with their racial caste? Now, given this, it becomes clear why someone like Iturbide would adamantly oppose the rebel forces which actively sought to overturn the very system that allowed him to live in privilege, and live in privilege he did. In fact, records show that in 1816, Iturbide amassed a large fortune through the abuse of his power as an officer of the royalist army. One example of this corruption is the use of his position as a military commander in order to create commercial monopolies in areas under his control. Now, aside from his shady business practices, it is also said that Iturbide was arbitrarily cruel to the families of known insurgents. He is said to have incarcerated the wives and children of known insurgents as a form of punishment for having their husbands or fathers fighting for the insurgent forces. Now, due to these accusations, eventually Iturbide would be relieved of his duties in 1816. However, by 1820, Iturbide would be reinstated as an officer within the royalist military. His reinstatement was due to the petitioning from royalist supporters of his. See, before his dismissal, Iturbide had actually distinguished himself as a very capable leader and a good strategist. And since his defeat of Morelos 5 years prior, the Mexican independence movement had actually lost a lot of steam. And Iturbide was seen as the right man for the job to finally put an end to this insurgent movement, which at the time was being led by Vicente Guerrero. So now that it's 1820 and Iturbide has been reinstated into his position as a royalist officer, we also have to talk about some events going on in Spain. See, earlier in the year, Spain had a successful revolt which reestablished Spain's constitution of 1812, reverting Spain to a constitutional monarchy. The revolt also led to the start of a 3-year period of liberal rule in Spain known as the Trienio Liberal. And this all occurred in 1820, the same year that Iturbide was reinstated into the royalist army. When news of the liberal victory in Spain reached Mexico, it was a cause for concern amongst the Mexican elites as it threatened the status quo. And the threat came from the fact that the liberal government in Spain might be willing to make some concessions to the predominantly liberal rebels. They might be willing to cave on things like racial equality, or perhaps even land redistribution, which might affect the power structure that the predominantly conservative Mexican elites were trying to hang on to. And as such, Iturbide saw an opportunity to mobilize the predominantly conservative elites of Mexico towards supporting an independence movement for the sole purpose of preserving the power structure already existing in Mexico. The power structure that put criollos en peninsulares at the top and everyone else below them. And this is my point. So let's recap. At the beginning, Iturbide was asked to lead the rebel forces and he denied it. He claimed it was due to the rebels being unprofessional, due to the atrocities they had committed at the start of the war. As a respected and competent military leader, Iturbide could have easily trained the ragtag rebel force into a more professional fighting force. Iturbide also bragged about his execution of rebels in celebration of Good Friday, this being partly due to the fact that he saw them as sacrilegious. What we can deduce from that is that he was already adamantly against the rebellion, which he saw as a threat to the status quo, which put people like him in a privileged position. And given that the rebels were predominantly liberal and some of their goals included things like land redistribution and the abolishment of the racial caste system, there's no surprise Iturbide would be opposed to their success. Given that the Mexican caste system was solely based on a person's race, we can see why he would be interested in preserving the system which granted him and people like him their status and their privilege. This very system also prevented Afro-Mexicans, mestizos, indigenous Mexicans, access to jobs, access to certain ranks within the military or positions in government. And the 1820 liberal success in Spain threatened that status quo. And seeing their power threatened, Iturbide and the criollo conservative classes of New Spain moved towards support of independence. Iturbide was opposed to independence until the privileges afforded to him by his status in the caste system were threatened by the new liberal government in Spain. Then all of a sudden, he supported independence from that government. And that right there is why I don't consider him a hero of Mexico's independence. Because his move to support Mexican independence was solely for the preservation of the power structures in Mexico. Yes, the Plan of Iguala, which he wrote, abolished the caste system and moved Mexico towards racial equality, theoretically. The Plan of Iguala actually preserved a lot of the power dynamic that already existed in Mexico, despite technically abolishing the caste system, because it guaranteed that white Europeans would essentially maintain their privileged positions. The plan guaranteed that upon transition towards independence, white Europeans would retain their existing positions in government, the church, civilian business, as well as the military. Essentially, it created equality on paper while maintaining the exact same power structure, which put white Mexicans in a position of privilege and oppressed mestizos, Afro-Mexicanos, and indigenous Mexicans. It is for this reason that the plan was rejected by insurgent leaders such as Juan Alvarez and Pedro Asensio and Gordiano Guzman, who recognized that the plan guaranteed the elites their privileges while at the same time welcoming opportunists like Iturbide, who only supported independence when it was beneficial to them. Now, did the combination of both the insurgent and royalist forces guarantee Mexico's independence? Of course! This compromise did indeed liberate Mexico. Does that mean that Iturbide was a hero for basically brokering this alliance? Absolutely not, because he only did it for his benefit and the benefit of his privileged elite class. And that is the reason I don't consider this man a hero. That's the reason I don't think he's worthy of the praise that he gets. I don't think this is someone that we should be looking up to. I don't think that this man is a hero on par with people like José María Morelos or Miguel Hidalgo or Vicente Guerrero or Guadalupe Victoria or even El Pipila. Anyway, that's my opinion on Agustin de Iturbide and why I don't see him as a hero of Mexico's independence. But let me know what you think. Put down in the comments, do you think this guy was a hero of Mexico's independence? Or are you in the same boat as me, where you see him as nothing but an opportunist who only supported the independence movement when it came down to preserving his power and the power of his class? And as always, my sources, the sources that I use to make my points, to write my scripts, are going to be down in the description if you want to read more about this on your own. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe for more Mexican history content. Don't forget to check me out on TikTok, which is the same as here, Internet Mexican. Thank you guys for watching. I'll see you guys next time. Peace.